Hey, this is Saran. I think mic is not needed. Oh, sorry guys, the schedule has postponed 1 hour. Okay, I was expected to take at 3:30. Okay, so a little bio about my side. For past 10 years, I'm working in Perl, and I'm an open source contributor for the next version of Perl. So presently, I work at Yahoo. So Perl is mainly, you know, my bread and butter. So in this session, we'll talk about the basic syntax and, you know, when to use Perl and, you know, the Perl open source communities and all kind of stuff. So feel free to ask, you know, any questions. So this is a little concept about the Perl background actually. So what is Perl? It's just an, you know, practical extraction and report language. It's just an acronym. So mainly, you know, at around 1980s, Larry Bell started writing some set of batch programs. Okay, that's the initial basic step to write Perl. So the batch program is enhanced, and then, you know, they started writing Perl, and it is mainly helpful for system admins and for testing. For test automations, they use Perl the most. So if you know C, you know, the syntax is more familiar. It will be same like C. It gets this power of shed and awk. So it's just a normal Perl program structure actually. Normally, like, you know, you will find a lot of Perl code which started with hash exclamation, user bin, Perl and kind of stuff. So this is the location of Perl interpreter. So this is mandate. Or while executing the command, you need to give the exact path of the Perl interpreter. Okay, hash is used as a command statement, and you know, you'll have a variable declarations, function prototypes and function definitions, and main program and kind of stuff. So it is a simple program, you know, the print is an output statement. Okay, so probably, so program executions. So you need to have an execute permission for the program. And you need to start, you know, Perl and then the program name. I'll get into the demo. So to check whether the Perl is installed in your machine, you can just using Perl-V. So of course, all Linux machines comes with Perl installed. So you need to install of its own. So if you give Perl-V, it just gives this, what is the version and all kind of details. So before getting into Perl, you know.
Perl-5 is the latest one, is it?
Perl-6 is ongoing. Perl-5.14 is the latest actually. Okay. So if you are in Windows guys, you need to download, there are different Perl flavors. You can go for, you can search for Active Perl. So that is mainly for Windows, and there is a Strawberry Perl. So you can download it. Strawberry Perl, and you can use this for Windows. So you need to have an execute permission. Okay, so before Perl-WC is mainly to check whether it's a syntax, to check the syntax. Okay, it will basically, you know, checks for any syntax error and warning kind of stuff. So just a compilation check. It says syntax is okay. Okay. Just prints let Perl be happy. So you need to have an execute permission. By default, you know, I've set this umask as need to execute permission. So this is to execute a simple command. Let's consider if you need to have, if you need to, you know, have a help of specific functions, you can use this Perl doc if an I is in case sensitive and F is function, if you need like print or something, it gives this man page of every specific functions. So this you may find it easy. You know, I is for insensitive, like the print may be caps or small whatever, F is for function. So the common error what you face, you know, in the initial phase of developing a Perl program, like it says, you know, your system could not find the Perl program, or you know, user local bin Perl not found or something like that. So I think this is simple and you can debug it. Okay, maybe if the Perl is not found, it says that Perl is not installed properly on a machine. Okay, so the program is not found, it could be, you know, you haven't given the absolute path of the file program or something like that. So before getting into that, like you have some expectations when coming to this session, right? So what is that you are interested to learn actually? Like any advanced topic or any specific topic I need to focus on, or something your input sounds to be more useful for me. Basically good introductions. So is it very basic?
Yeah, basically, I am starting for...
Oh, okay. So, am I going very basic or is that fine?
Yeah, very basic.
Okay, that's fine, right? Okay. So, this is fine. I think I've already explained. See, this has exclamation, it notes. After that, it should be on the first line. It's just the path of the Perl interpreter. Okay? So, basically, there are three data types. Here you don't need to worry about. In C you have integer, character and all kind of stuff, float and kind of stuff. Okay, so is my voice okay? This is one of the interview questions as well, the first interview question. Basic three data types. Scalar. Usually denote with dollar symbol. Let's consider dollar value. You can store an integer, a float, whatever it may be, string or whatever it may be. Okay, you can also store string, whatever it may be, it automatically takes care. Perl automatically takes care of the type of values. So another data, I think I'll get into this another data type. Okay. Let's consider if the values, you know, are getting expanded more than 10 digits or something like. So it automatically takes to the exponential form. So it's just a simple program to calculate the simple interest. I think we can just skip this part. Okay. So stdin. Okay, I'll execute this program. So the next line, I'm going to say, you know, print enter the name. Don't get confused with this dollar. As of now, no. This is a standard input. Okay. So it asks, it just the stdin prompts the user to enter the name. Okay. Let's say I'm entering my name. See, I haven't given new line character, but it says, hey Sharan, and then it is giving a new line prompt. Okay, so the reason is, while you are giving in the stdin, after Sharan you are pressing enter key, right? That new line character also will be stored in the scalar variable. So you need to remove that. Basically, if you are, you know, comparing with other other values or something, right? The new line character also will be getting added in the scalar variable. While comparing, it will return basically false. So first, the basic thing what you need to do is you need to chomp it. There are functions like chomp and chop. So if we give chomp of dollar name, it just chomps the new line character at the end of it. Okay, so that is the basic stuff you need to do when you are getting an input from the user. So now if we execute the same program, see, it just prints at the same line. You got the difference, right? Before, it just prints the new line character. After that, now it doesn't lose it. Chomp basically truncates the new line character. So there are functions like, you know, length, which basically finds the length of the value. So for comparison operator, normally for numerical comparison, you use this less than greater than symbol, and if you need to compare with string, you need to use LT, GT, and you know, all those stuff. So hope you guys will be familiar with this comparison operator, right? Okay. So as if like C programming having an if else, while and until, it is basically same as in like C. Okay. It's just a basic, you know, example to use the if statement. It's same as in like C. So here is the difference. Like, see, if you are using a less than symbol for numerical values, it checks the whole value. Instead, if you use the LT, which is used for mainly string comparison, it checks the first character, 1 and 4. So for string comparison, you use this LT and GT symbol, and for numerical comparison, you need to use this less than greater than. Okay, so you got the difference, right? So if you are using an less than symbol for numerical values, it compares the whole value. Rather than if you're using this LT symbol, it takes the first digit 1 and 4, it compares it. So logical operators. So this is OR and same as in like C. Okay, so instead of having a multiple statement, multiple, you know, the nested if, you can have it in a single statement using this AND. Okay, so basically you know to use the conditional operators. Concatenation. I am giving a new line character to, you know, differentiate. Okay, so here the dot is a concatenation operator. Okay, and I am printing dollar line here. Okay. So it asks for the name. Okay. Here I am basically doing a concatenation operator using dot. So the one more interesting thing in Perl is there is an X. Okay, so basically it multiples. See here, I have just given x and then the 5. So this word automatically gets multiplies. Normally if you need to, you know, print in a structured format like, you know, using a formatted output like using plus symbol or hyphen symbol or something, like, you know, if you need to give. Basically, if you need to format it like a continuous line or hyphen or something, we can use this X. So you will be familiar with this dot equal to, right? So dot equal to is normally, like, let's consider dollar A dot equal to India is, basically we can write it as dollar A equal to dollar A dot. Dollar A dot equal to India or something it is there. So it means dollar A equal to dollar A dot India. That is dot. I think in C also it is there actually. Yeah, assignment of. Okay. So now let's get into arrays. So I'm going to very basic, you know, since you need to learn very basic stuff. So we have talked about scalar. It's the single entity of a value. Array is nothing but group of scalar values. Okay, you are just grouping all those scalar variables and you are forming an array. So you are grouping scalar variables. It can be, you know, numerical values, or it can be a string, or it can be a float value or something. So it automatically takes care of data types. Okay, so you are just grouping one or more scalar variables and you are forming an array. The main difference is for array you are using at symbol here. For scalar, it is a single value, you are using a dollar symbol. Okay, to distinguish between array variables from scalar. Okay, so how do you find, let's consider how you need to access the elements in an array. So the indexing starts from 0, 1, 2, like that. Okay. So if you need to access a specific elements, I'll say like print dollar array of 2, it basically prints value key. Probably I'll show you a simple demo. So you got it right. So, So I'm declaring an array. Okay, I'm printing the index 2. It means it starts with 0, 1, 2. So here also you have a negative indexing. You can, you know, start with negative indexing, you know the concept, right? You can have minus 1 at the last and you can, you know, print the negative way of it.
Can you explain?
Negative indexing. Okay. See, in the reverse way, you can just, you know, use minus 4, minus 3, minus 2, plus it. Okay. Shall you? You got 5, right? Got it. It's C. This is minus 1 and this is minus 2. Okay. Probably I can just give minus. Okay, you got. See, here you are declaring 4 elements in the array and then you are, you know, assigning the index of 6. So it means, you know, the value null will be stored in the index of 4 and 5. So it automatically takes care of that. Okay, so you have a range operator. Let's consider if you are giving A to Z. It automatically, you know, assigns the complete list of it. So as is used for commenting. See it. I think I need to give some other. Say the last 5th element. It prints B. So the range operator automatically assigns from A to Z. Okay. So how do you copy one array to another array? By simply assigning, you know, to another array, it automatically copies all the elements in an array. So how do you find the length of an array? So this is also one of the important question, interview question what people ask, normally ask. So there are many ways. If you assign a whole array to a scalar, let's consider instead of at, if you give dollar result, so it gives the number of elements in an array. Okay, that is one simple step. If you are assigning the whole array to a scalar variable, dollar result, okay, it will not store the first element in an array or something like. It gives the total number of elements in an array. Okay, that is one method. And this is scalar. You are converting the whole array context into scalar. You are having, you know, the whole number of array elements. And if you just convert it into scalar, it gives the total count of the array. Total number of elements in an array. Okay, so the another method is dollar hash is points to the last index. See, let's consider here. The index is starting from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So this dollar hash of array gives 4, the last index. So normally if you need to print the original count, you can give 4 plus 1. So that gives the original count of it.
Just one question.
Yeah.
Previously we have 0, 1, 2, 3, and now you assign dollar 6, that means 6th. Array of 6.
Okay.
Between before that two null came.
Yes, yes.
Now if you found the array size.
Okay.
It's like here. Is it including null?
Yes, it will include null also. Okay. So there are built-in functions with array. You can sort it. Okay. You can just normal sort is a lexical sort. Okay. So. Can also get a detailed sort using this Perl doc -f sort gives all those sort related functions. can, you know, have an insensitive sort. You can take the first letter and you can just sort it. There are lots of ways you can play with sort actually. Okay, I'll get into hash and then probably you'll get a better idea of how sorting works. Center subject by default it uses the quick sort. How do you reverse an array? It's very simple. You use a reverse function, so it does reverse it. So there is a command called join. Let's consider you have an array and you need to join into a scalar variable. You have this join functions. Split. So you have a complete string like you have a list of names or you know you have sentence and you need to split with some pattern. You can use the split. So probably I'll get into this join and split. So am I going too basic or like I can skip off this?
It's good.
Sorry?
It's good.
It's good, right? First A to Z, okay, let me...
Just to interrupt, we have a feedback session at 5:30 in Asteroids, ground floor that is. So please feel free to join us. We'd love to hear what you liked, what you didn't like, what can we do better. And there's a special from Ola Gaps for one.
See, in the statement, okay, so I'm assigning the range operator. So A to Z will be assigning this array. So I'm using join statement. It basically takes every element and combines with comma. Okay, so if you just print with A comma B comma C, the whole stuff. So this is how the join works.
Can you explain it again, please?
Okay. Sure, thanks for asking. Let me remove this stuff. Okay, if it is confusing, I'll remove this. Okay. So, in this array, we have different elements like 1, 3, 5, and string, okay? So let's remove this.
So comma, we have written comma, like after
yeah.
Join, that's a pattern.
Yeah, that's the pattern, you are going to join it, okay?
And what else can be the pattern?
It can be anything, like let's consider, instead we can have colon. Okay, if we give it, you're joining based on any pattern actually. Yeah, you can include. Let's consider. So it includes.
Scalar.
Yeah, which one? The whole array will be just stored as a scalar.
It
just joins.
It's stored as a string.
Single scalar variable. So it's
okay.
Basically a string. So there are, you don't need to worry about data types, whether it's an you know string or integer or float. Or
okay.
Perl takes care of that. So the lookup time of hash is O of 1. So hash is nothing but, in Python you say is dict, in Perl you say it is hash. Okay, so it has a key value pair. For every meaningful key you store it as a value. In array you store with, let's consider you store with, you know, index 0, 1, 2, 3. But in hash you store with a meaningful name. Let's consider, you know, 1 or 2 or 5 or something. You are giving a meaningful name for every value. Okay. So how the lookup time is 1 is, it's an internal of hash. So let's consider if you are storing, you know, thousands of key value pair, and if you need to search for a single key, it just goes and picks it at 0 of 1 time. It takes the key, let's consider the key is 1 or something, it takes every single character and store as, it will compute the ASCII value, just combines the ASCII value. Okay, that will be taken as the index and it points out in the single sort. So that's the, you know, the beautiful lookup time, it's O of 1. Okay. So in detail, there is a lot of, you know, bucketing systems and all kind of stuff. It will be more interesting. And in real time, normally people use hash a lot. So let's consider here, and this is the name, this is the key, and the value is just an any value. So by using this key, you are accessing this value. Instead of giving indexes like 0 or 1, it will be more confusing to you. Instead, if you have a meaningful name, it sounds to be, you know, more interesting. See here, I'm assigning the hash. So this is the key and this is value. And this is key and this is value. Okay.
So what's the use? Why do we do hashing?
Hashing. Okay, let's consider you have an environment variable. In an every shell you have an environment variable, right? So let's consider see, you have list of environment variables. Okay. So you need to store this somewhere and you need to use it. Like similar set of data sets, you need to store somewhere. And see, let's consider you can just store this as key and this as value. Okay. So instead of, you know, specifically mentioning the index and kind of thing, indexing means you need to remember at which index this value comes or something like, and this can be, you know, this can be changing at many times. So instead by using this key like command underscore mode, if you just store all this in hash and if you just give the key command underscore mode, it just gives the value. That way, you know, you are getting an easy access to the data. And of course the runtime is fast. Let me get into example.
After the session, please head to Asteroid for the feedback.
Here this is key and this is value. Okay, so I'm printing the value of the key floor. Okay, let's see what is the output. Okay. So this can be also stored in a different way. If it sounds to be more confusing, you know. Store this, it means the reference will be stored here. Okay, you can also assign hash, like, you know. You can also store hash in this kind of meaningful way or something like that. Let's consider if you need to delete. Okay. There is a delete function which deletes.
Here you assign the values to hash scalar, right?
Yeah, yeah. It means, you know, the memory value will be stored here. That's why I am dereferencing with the symbol. So I am trying to explain. You can store it in an easy representation way. Instead of comma, it may look confusing for you, right? So that's why, you know, you can just store it as a reference and give it as a.
I understand. It's
yeah.
Whatever we assign, but the hashes belongs to percentage, right?
Yeah. See, percentage. So I'll tell you about referencing. It's just a pointer. I'm using a pointer here. Okay, so let's consider if you're passing an whole hash to your function. So if you're passing a whole hash to your function, it takes more memory. Instead, you just pass a pointer, the value by reference. It sounds to be more useful, right? So I'm just using the reference here. Okay. Arrays, right? Arrays also you can use it. Okay, so I'll finish with this. So, okay. So there is a function called delete. So I think you can easily, it will delete the specific key and value. Okay. So if you just give perl doc -if, it basically use, you know, how to use delete and kind of stuff. Let me get into your question. See, here you have array, okay. Here I'm just referencing the whole array, okay. So if you want to print, is it sounds confusing to you?
Slash is escaping.
Oh, sorry. Okay. No, this is the correct slash. Let's consider.
The syntax is slash.
Yeah, slash. It gives the reference. Okay. So you got it right? So the delete statement used to delete a specific key. So there is a function called keys. It basically lists out all the keys. Okay. And there is a function called values, which basically lists out all the values. Then we can just ignore this. So the control structure is the for each do. This for is a regular C for. Okay, I'm not going into this for. For each. Okay, I'll get into for each. It's just a normal C syntax. Okay, for each. For each is specific. It solves lot of your computations. Let's consider. I'm going to delete. See the for each, if you are using a for statement, you need to find the number of elements in an array, and then you need to set an incremental variable or something like. For each automatically takes care of that. For each statement, what it does is like it iterates every single element and it assigns to this variable. So it simplifies your process. I am going to discuss this on the last slide. It's just scope of variables, like declaring the global variables and specific to the block level and kind of stuff. Okay, so you got it right. So it iterates through every element and it assigns in this variable. So last statement what it does is like it just breaks the loop, okay, and then it comes out of the loop.
Like break.
So here you use last. So these are the differences from C. Like next. What next is does is it just skips the remaining portion and it trace to just goes to the next.
Like continue.
Continue.
Skip, bypass the
continue here, use next. So these are the small differences. Okay, so here continue, see.
Different and next, what is the difference between next and continue?
See, next, it just skips this part, okay. Let me get in detail. See, let's consider you are evaluating an expression, and if you do a continue, okay, you are doing something else. Okay, let's consider in the while block normally use a continue statement. Okay, so you can go to this Perl doc, you'll get an explanation of when to use continue. Continue is normally used in while block. Okay, so I'll tell about. Basically, an end of while loop or until loop is reached. Let's consider at the end of the while loop, you can have some statements like incrementer or something like. Okay, so normally continue people don't use it. See, however, if you are breaking the loop also, continue statement just gets runs. Okay. So before that, there is an redo. Let's consider, instead of next, if you give redo, it starts from the beginning of that, beginning of the iteration. And it just redoes the same stuff. Okay?
Beginning of that iteration?
Beginning of that iteration, not that the initial iteration. Beginning of that iteration. So the variable scoping. There are basically three scopes. One is my, okay, my and our local. You have a block or a function. Here a function, you can write it using a sub and then the function name, something like that, okay. So you are declaring a variable, let's say my dollar var equal to 10 or something. So this value, this variable value will remain only in this block, that we are using my. If you are using R, dollar val won't equal 10 or something. Even outside of the function also, if you just print dollar val 1, it just prints, it's just a global declaration. Okay, so local is something, you have already a global variable, okay. You have an already, you know, some environment variable, something blah blah blah. Okay, inside the function you need to change it. Only inside function. Okay. So you are already having a global variable and inside the function you need to change it. So inside this block, this value will be there. Once it comes out of it, the global value will be retained.
If we declare the overing block.
Okay.
Then local in, then the same block, then which value?
Okay. You our in same block and local.
Yeah, can do.
Yeah, you can do both, but it, there is no necessity. It
then
only has the same value.
Which value will be I show?
See, R, see, if you are declaring like the same like R dollar env equal to something,
yeah.
Okay, and local. So whatever the value which is assigned local, it will be, which will be stored. Because see, you are declaring R first and then local. Local replaces inside the block. Okay. So if you see here.
Once it comes out of the block?
Once it comes out of the, our will be replaced. Our will be coming.
Our is the global.
Yeah, the global. Okay. Got it?
Means if you are not mentioning local.
Okay.
If you assign any value, the global value changes. Will
the global value will not change. Okay.
No, outside is value 10.
Okay. Let me. See, I am declaring a global variable, okay, equal to 10. I have a function or block, okay, so
don't,
here.
Don't use local.
Oh, okay.
Just dollar variable equal to 20.
Okay.
Outside, if you outside of the function, what is dollar value?
It will be 20 only, 20.
Okay.
Because that will be replaced.
If you use local?
If you use local,
then
only here only the 20 will be printed. Only here 20 gets printed. Here 10 will be replaced. Okay, only specifically inside the function you are just changing the values. Outside it just goes to the global.
If you use my instead of local?
Instead of local, if you use my, it just throws syntax error. Because it is already defined globally. Okay.
My just for the one block.
Yeah, only for the specific block. So, when to use Perl?
So, local is used for only global variables we need to.
Yeah, only at the time you can use local.
No other purpose.
No other purpose. So, when to use Perl? So, the regular expression is the real power of Perl, the pattern matching. Let's consider you have an, you know, GB of data and you need to pass a specific email ID or something. That's what the regular expression comes in picture. So, the Perl the main real power in Perl is regular expressions. Okay, it uses this the finite automata. It's altogether, you know, it's a good topic, but it's more about, you know, getting in detail. And another thing is like the network programming. Okay, you need to connect to a socket level communication, and if you concurrently run many threads. So in Yahoo, we were, you know, deploying to thousands of servers. So Perl multi-threading, you know, which should be very helpful to deploy it, you know, more than 10,000 servers parallelly. So the main beauty in Perl is the open source community. So whatever you're thinking to write a function or something, that will be available already in CPAN. CPAN is a comprehensive Perl local network. Okay. Let's consider, you need to find whether the email address is valid or something like. So already people will have written for this. So you need to import this module, okay? And you can just start using this. So you need to worry about regular expressions. They take care of all those stuff actually. See, you need to install this module, and here is the use statement. Use and then the module name. So it takes care of that. So whatever, let's consider. Sysad means normally they need to connect to different servers. Okay, through FTP, sorry. through telnet or something like. So here is the module, okay. See, you are giving a host name or any server name, and you are giving a username or password, okay. And you can execute whatever the command. Let's consider you are developing a monitoring system. You need to monitor 100 or thousands of servers. You need to check the disk space usage, okay. So you need to raise an alert if the disk space is more than 85% or something. Okay, so instead of going and checking manually, you can write a script that goes and log into a different parallel 2000 host or whatever. You can just have a username and password. You can run a command like disk usage du-f or something like. So you can have a check like if it exceeds 85%, you can just raise alert or something like. Okay, so this kind of task we can do it. Okay, and let's consider spam. So there are many modules they have written to, you know, identify whether this is a spam mail or something like. So everything you can find it in this cpan.org. So in the last meetup, one guy has given a demo. He has used a headset mic, and it detects your heartbeat. And it acts as stethoscope. Some guy has written a module over there. See, you got it right by using the headphone mic. Basically, if you just keep a mic over here, it just detects your heartbeat, and you know it just checks your bytes. If there is sound, the byte will get increased at that point, right? So by that way, they find this heartbeat, and so there are lots of module. I'm trying to explain. You know, there are lots of Perl module which is available based on your real time. Like, let's consider. Maybe you can tell an example like, so maybe on real time you would be, you have some requirement, right? As a system admin or something like, let's consider, you need to find the usage. Instead of frequently, you know, manually checking the netstat command, here is this Perl module which does that, and you can just set an alert mechanism or something like that. Okay. So another important beauty is like perlmonks.org. It's like stackoverflow.com. You can post your questions, and within 5-10 minutes people will answer it. Okay, so you get a lot of support from open source community.
You tell me
the
Sturdy Perl and Active Perl.
Yeah, for Windows. So the difference is, it's just a flavor. Active Perl, the installation way is, you know, it takes it just it uses an exe. The strawberry perl is more of, you know, getting the source code and just compiles it. Okay, and there are it's just a flavor of it. There will be few differences, you know, in terms of the support and kind of stuff. Maybe like there will be few differences, like, you know. So the recent versions, you know, it includes this Perl binaries like compilers and all kind of stuff. So the people, you know, they'll be upgrading their versions. So there will be some few enhancements and kind of stuff. So if there is any enhancements over here, the ActivePerl will copy that, you know, and ActivePerl will release the next versions. One more thing is, like, we are running a meetup group. So we are hosting it, you know, at our Yahoo office every month.
Yeah, before 2 weeks, I wrote Perl's MOOC.
Yeah, yeah. So you get some lot of interesting topics over there.
You work in Yahoo?
Yes.
And who will be develop the heartbeat?
Yeah, that is this
Venkatesh.
Guy called Venkatesh. Yeah,
Venkatesh.
Yeah, yeah.
I know that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So last time
my brother came, and also my brother in Yahoo in previous month he lived, Ashish Gupta.
Oh, Ashish Gupta. Okay,
yeah.
Okay. So you find lot of sessions. So the demand for Perl market is usually high, right?
Yeah.
For a fresher, if you learn some Perl stuff, you'll be easily hired. So the public pool is very less actually. Okay, that's it. We are close to 5:30. Okay, you can reach out to me by, you know.
There is another meetup with the Perl Smugglers in Yahoo. When?
We will keep posted.
Okay, okay.
So we are finding out the venue actually. So this is my email address. You can shoot out to me if you, in case if you need any Perl doubts. Let's consider if you want to find a job or something like on Perl or something, you can just come to the meetup, or you can just send out a mail to.
Yeah, basically I'm now fresher. I complete my.
Yeah, yeah.
Here. That's why.
So if you learn Perl and you can just come to the meetup, and if you can, you know, do something on Perl, and if you post your resume, you can you'll get easily hired.
Okay.
So they are looking for a lot of Perl freshers actually.
Okay.
There is an. So this is the Perl Mongoose group.
Okay.
Okay, if you learn something Perl, or if you want to learn Perl and if you want to get a job, you can just send out a mail. You need to subscribe to the mailing list. So there are a lot of demand for Perl guys. So I know I have run through very Perl basic concepts. I feel, you know, the basic this data types, everything, it is very important. Okay, probably in the meetup you can get to know about more advanced topics and kind of stuff. That's it, we are reaching 5:30. Thanks guys.